thank you, Paige, for reading that. What we hear there and see there in Ephesians 4 is a picture of sanctification, or becoming more like Jesus. And so I put a picture on your bulletin to kind of help you understand what sanctification looks like. So we have this picture here of a fence and a caution sign. It should be the first slide in the sermon. There it is. That's on your bulletin, too. And that's to keep people who aren't wearing a hard hat and aren't safe in, on the outside of that. It says, construction site, unauthorized persons keep out. When you accept Christ as Savior, when I accept Christ as Savior into our life, he puts a protection around us and says, okay, you've heard some awful voices, you've had some terrible thoughts come in, but I'm going to protect you from that. I want you to hear what Holy Spirit has to say to you. He's authorized. I'm going to have what God's Word says to you. That's authorized. I'm going to want you to hear God's Word preached from people who are a part of your church family. That's those are the authorized people that are allowed in. And we look at our lives and we see, oh my goodness, what a mess. And God looks at our lives and says, we broke ground. We're getting ready to start. It's going to be beautiful. It's going to be amazing what your life will become. And all we see is that stage. Or maybe we get to the point where we see the foundation done and we see some posts going up for walls and structure. And we feel so exposed. And we think, oh my goodness, I'm trying to do what God wants me to do, but I feel so vulnerable. And God says, that's okay. I'm not done yet. Stick with me. I'm going to protect you. This is a construction site. This is sanctification. And then we get to the point where the outside walls, the outside part of the building is done. We think, oh. And Holy Spirit whispers in your ear, we're still not done. There's wiring we've got to do. We're going to work on this for the rest of your life to build you into the person, into the kingdom member that I created you to be. But there's another picture that I want us to look at, because sometimes on that construction fence, this one doesn't have one. But a lot of times when you see a wall around a construction project, you also see a picture of what's going to happen. So let's go to the next slide. This is a building that they're going to build in downtown Fort Worth. It's not there yet. They start in 2025 if everything goes according to plan. But that's an artist's rendition of what's going to happen in the construction site. And a lot of times you'll see that. You'll see coming soon, and then you'll see a picture of what they haven't even built yet. That's the same thing God does in our lives. When he begins the process of sanctification, when we allow him into our hearts, he says, there is a picture of what your life is to be. And that picture is none other than our Lord Jesus Christ. We're created in God's image. And the picture of Christ is the one that the artist is looking at, or the architect is looking at as he builds. And they're going to, I don't have that picture in the bulletin, but think about what that would be like. Your construction site, and everybody sees that they can't mess with you because something's happening, but they look through the fence and think, well, that looks like, I'm not sure, that's great. And then they see the picture of what's going to be built. And they see the artist's rendering of what has not actually happened yet, but promises to be. As we become more and more like Christ, those construction sites bring glory to him. God looks at any stage of your life in him, and he smiles and he's joyful, because he not only sees where you are now, but where you're going to be created in his image. The construction site idea, I think, is a good way to look at what is kind of hard to understand. But the truth is, we take this from Philippians 1:6, that he who started the work is faithful to complete the work. So if you'll go back one section to that video, let's just kind of sing this along with some beautiful pictures. This wonderful truth from Philippians 1:6. Everybody just take a posture of prayer, or you just sing along with the words, but realize that
He's not done.
He who began a good work in you
faithful to complete that good work. I'd like to read you a quote from Tim Keller. To be loved but not known is comforting, but it's superficial. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear. But to be fully known and truly loved is, well, a lot like being loved by God. It's what we need more than anything. Let's take a look at Ephesians 4, verse 25 one more time. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Verse 25, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Man, that's good advice. Do you ever have something that you know needs to be fixed with a friend or a coworker or a family member? And you want, and then you go to bed and you can't sleep because it's so so much pain inside. God wants us to take that moment, that day, to try to mend relationships in every way that we possibly can, because He knows that when we are united with Him, that each day can have its own blessing and its own forgiveness. Also in Ephesians 4, picking up in 27, give no opportunity to the devil.
that the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. I have spent the summer thinking about the relationships with my teaching assistants this year. And it's not going to be an easy road. It just isn't. Sarah knows what that's like, to have an assistant that's difficult to do daily. And the one thing that I'm going to have to truly guard is, what kind of words come out of my mouth? What kind of heart do I have towards these two people who are kind of rough around the edges? Nobody else in the building wants to work with them. And yet, God has set aside this season for me to be their leader, their teacher that they assist. So pray with me as I continue to try to be more of what Jesus is, because I can just fall short so many times in so many ways. Verse 30 says, "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you are sealed for the day of redemption." If you're interested in this whole idea of grieving the Holy Spirit, or Jesus' challenges in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, warns people not grieve the Holy Spirit. It's the curse, but I can't remember the actual word. Anyway, if you want to read an article about not grieving the Holy Spirit, I do have an article printed in the back there. It's by Dave Mathis. I read this and I really love this. He's the editor of desiringgod.org. And Jesus said to the scribes, I truly encourage you to read that article. I hate when a word just escapes me. But that will explain this whole grieving of the Holy Spirit and what it means to blaspheme the Holy Spirit. What that means. When I was a teenager, it was something that blaspheming the Holy Spirit was the unforgivable sin. I mean, any of you receive that kind of teaching. And so, we as teenagers would wonder, what if I've done that? What if I've done a sin that's so bad that I can't be redeemed? I can't be forgiven, because that's an unforgivable sin. And we used to wonder if that was a trap that we'd fall in. And if you have ever wondered about that, I wonder if maybe I didn't mean to, but maybe I've spoken out, or maybe I was mad at God. Maybe I did say some things to God that were not a loving expression at all. Take a look at that article and read that article and get that settled for yourself. If you're here, if you're seeking not to blaspheme the Holy Spirit, guess what? Then you're not doing it. You're not committing a sin that can't be forgiven if you're honestly seeking to love Him and to have Him change your life. Let all bitterness and wrath, verse 31, Ephesians 4 still, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Kindness. God's kindness. It's so needed in our world. There's so many people who don't live with much kindness at all. And as the teacher in my classroom, I sometimes will catch myself making a face that is not a kind expression. I try not to say the words. I try to get the words stopped, but sometimes I'll have a shrugging of the shoulders or a face that indicates that I'm not full of kindness, and I need to be. I want to be. I want to be a life full of His grace, to extend that grace to others. So we're going to take this concept of building one another up, and we're going to talk about what we need less of and what we need more of. So we've got this less and this more category. And maybe this is helpful to you, because sometimes we think all right, well, I've got some of that stuff that's on the less. And because I got a certain measure of it, therefore, I'm not doing what God, and we put ourselves in a whole lot of pressure. These are continuums. In other words, we need to do some lessons. There's some things in my life, there's some things in your life that we need to do less of. But we have a replacement behavior over here on the more. And guess what? If we do more of what's in this column, the less you can't continue to do those things. So let's do the first pair. The first was taking and giving. We tend to be very consumer oriented. We tend to want to get and to take and to keep and to hoard and to hold on to. We want to take, and God calls us to give. When we start to allow His heart to change our heart, and we start to give more of our time, give more of our energy, give more of our skills to Him and to His kingdom, we won't be taking, because you can't do both at the same time. That's the beauty of a continuum. If you're working towards one end, you're leaving the other end. Do you understand that? That's fantastic. It's not that we're still not taking. We still have a problem there, but it's less taking because we're doing more giving. And that really is a good way to focus your mind on how is your sanctification process working on your own. Let's take a look at the next pair. We got lying and truth telling. Everybody in this room has told a lie, tried to deceive somebody sometime in your life.
Amen.
We've all done it. And some lies we tell because we don't want people to think the wrong, a bad thought. Or we lie because we're trying to cover up that which is hurtful or painful. So when we get to the point where we start telling the truth, telling the truth is easy until it's not. Because sometimes when you need to tell the truth to somebody, it's not something that they necessarily want to hear. Pastor John used to struggle with this. How do we express God's love, but also do correction at the same time? How do we say what you're doing is wrong and there's a better way to live your life and do that in God's love? That's hard. That's a God-sized task. Sometimes we need to tell the truth not only to others, we need to tell the truth to ourselves.
Amen.
Sometimes the worst lies that have changed lives are lies that people have told themselves. And they've gotten themselves convinced of something which God says that's not true. And how would you know God's truth if you don't get into His Word and find out what He's proclaimed for us, what He's given to us? So as we don't open our Bibles and seek to know God's truth. But as we learn to tell the truth, the lying begins to get less and less to God's glory. There's a continuum for it. I got eight of them. Let's go look at the next pair. Gossiping. Oosh. It is very, very easy for me to tell stories to people that I get along with really well at work about the people that I don't get along with that well at work. It is so easy to do, to tell them of an instance or tell them of something that person said or did. I just want to shake my head and think, ah. But I want to do that with somebody else. I want, and so that becomes gossip. Gossip is, there's nothing positive that comes out of that. We feel like we've unloaded a concern, but all we've done is make that concern grow, and now we have somebody else who isn't hearing the truth necessarily. They're not hearing anything encouraging. What would it be like if our church truly, truly encouraged one another more than we've ever done before? Now, we're pretty nice to each other. We love visitors that come in. We love each other, the people that we see every week. But what if we were so filled with encouragement that we had to go find people that need that encouragement
that that reservoir might be used up. I no longer drive limousines. I no longer drive the party buses on the weekend. So I've been thinking that on Fridays, I might get down to the Union Gospel Mission and just help. Help serve. Help families. Do whatever they need for volunteer work down there. Penny is involved in NEED, Northeast Emergency Distribution. And she's part of their board, and she's there regularly. Knows they're regularly helping and volunteering. What if the amount of encouragement that God put in our hearts was so big that we had to go find somebody that we knew was desperate, that we knew was covered up in sadness and filled with sorrow, and we went to encourage them? That would take time, that would take resources, that would take a mission. That would be something that would be way beyond our comfort zone or what happens naturally when we step into the supernatural and leave what happens easily and naturally for us. Let's take a look at the next pair. Build one another up with less fighting and more resolving. None of us in here have had a fight with each other that I know of. But we've had some anger with other people. And fighting is not just fist fighting, although my students sometimes do that. But the answer to less fighting, our world is full of fighting, by the way. You've got people, when they look at politics, the only thing they can do politically is to hate the other group, rather than look for what God wants us to do. To look for some resolving some issues. Wouldn't it be amazing if the city of Fort Worth looked at the churches in Fort Worth and said, that's where conflicts get resolved. That's where people don't dig in into their position. They don't try to stand and defend with that which God has defended. We sometimes want to do God's job and we want God to do our job. And we need to find out what that really would be if we reversed it. What if we allow God to do his job and we truly focused on resolving rather than speaking our mind? Sometimes we call it truth telling, and all it is trying to make someone else look bad or wrong. Next pair. We should have less bitterness and more forgiveness. I don't know any of you that is full of bitterness, but I know other people in the world that I work with and see that have quite a bit of bitterness. And if I'm honest, there's times that I can be bitter too. God wants me on a journey towards him with more of his love. And as I'm walking and living out forgiveness, Jesus said, forgive others as God has forgiven you. God will forgive you at that. The way you forgive other people. If we walk towards that, there's no room for bitterness left. Our lives are becoming sanctified. Two more. Next pair is rage and kindness. There's a wonderful book called Love Kindness. I wonder if sometime we'll get to go through it as a church family. But when we show kindness to others, that's something that God puts in us to be used. How many of you there's things that just really boil you up, just really make you angry? For me, it's inanimate objects. You too, Rossi? For me, it's inanimate objects. I don't get mad at people. I love people. But man, I sure can get mad at something that I thought I could fix quickly and I can't. It takes longer than I want it to be repaired or fixed. I can get very, very angry at inanimate objects, things that really aren't that much of an issue, or even frustration where things just don't work out very well. And God's really been kind of reminding me through the Holy Spirit that rage is sinful. That's the part of my life that needs to be put to death. So that I walk in kindness. me, I'm different places on these different continuums. But I want to be moving towards what God has. Last pair, cruelty and compassion. I tend to think that I'm pretty compassionate. I love other people and I want to do best for them. There's a whole lot of times where I just kind of bypass somebody. Say, somebody else can show that compassion. I'm too busy. I'm too busy to meet that need. I can see it. I can see that it's awful. And that's a cruel heart towards those who are suffering. I wonder what it would be like. I don't think this room could contain the people that would be touched if we truly, as individuals and as a church family, moved toward more compassion. If we became more and more giving and truth-telling and encouraging and resolving and forgiving and showing kindness, there'd be no way that this building could contain all the people that would want to be a part. We'd have to start new churches in other places. Because we'd look up and say, okay, we're at capacity. Let's get a group of us and go and show this to another neighborhood. Here's the truth. One more thing before we take that list down and we clear it off. This side over here, this should get your heart. It got mine. That list, that giving, truth, telling, encouraging, resolving, forgiveness, kindness, compassion, that's what Jesus showed you and me. This is what Christ gave us by giving his life and allowing his life to be taken on the cross. This is what we got. So when I ask you to move towards that and do more of that, I'm asking you to give what you received. And that's a crucial concept for us to get our heads around. God wants us to give what he has given us in the person of Jesus. Amen. Ephesians is written to a church that had been pretty divided, pretty angry at each other. Half the church were Jews who had come to Christ and become Christians. The other half of the church in Ephesus were non-Jews or Gentiles. And Christ had forgiven them too. And the Jews were pretty sure that there were some things about Judaism that those Gentiles needed to do. And the Gentiles, who were filled with Christ's love, were pretty sure that those Jews were still locked into some things that weren't. There was a division there. There was some real strife in Ephesus. Yeah. And so when Paul writes this letter, this is read and this church has changed as these people truly begin to become one. What if our church truly became one? Not just that we like each other. We already got that. We like being together. We like encouragement. But what if we became one in mission and became one in reaching out and became one in claiming the glory of God for his kingdom here? God can do way more than we can even imagine. And my prayer is that we'll seek him and that the sanctification process in our hearts and in our lives will become something that continually grows for his glory. And I see it in you. I know some of your stories and I know some of what God is doing, and I'm so grateful. I want to see even more though. I want to see others filled with God's love, but also us filled with a deeper sense of his love and his kindness, that that kindness might flow through us. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for all that you've done for our church family. We got blessings we sure don't deserve. And Lord, when we pray and ask you to come into our lives, you begin a process of sanctification. You
make us a construction site where we are created again in your image with blessings and gifts that we get to give to the world that will last for all eternity. So Lord, help us to spend some time and some resources and some energy into building your kingdom in us. Because when we do that, our gratitude grows. And we truly become thankful. Make us thankful people.
Yes, Lord.
Give us the kind of gratitude that others look and say, there's something going on. That person's way more joyful than they should be, or way more grateful than I understand. I wonder what it is that makes them like that. May our testimony be the words that we share, but even more the lives that we live for your glory and